So this is the last section of the chapter. Okay. And after this class, we will stop. So we will not have another class. Okay, then let's continue. Now we will go through the energy analysis of unsteady flow processes. Meaning the amount of mass within the control volume here, okay, may not be constant. Okay, right here, the mass may not be constant, control volume, and the amount of energy within the control volume, again, may not be constant. It may change. So you may have, you know, filling processes, discharging processes, so all kinds of unsteady processes. Now the question is, how do we deal with this? Okay, when things are not steady. We will make one major approximation here. Okay, uniform flow. It will mean that let's say we have something entering. Okay, we will assume the properties here, okay, are constant. Properties are constant. You can say, what if they are not constant? Then I'll say, we will take the average if necessary. If they are not constant, we will use some average value. Okay, otherwise things will get very complicated. So with that assumption, we can really deal with any kind of system. Okay, now keep in mind that a control volume, when things are not steady, may involve boundary work. Okay, let's say here you see our system, it looks like a closed system, right? Here's a system boundary. But we have mass entering. Therefore, is it a closed system? Of course not, because our mass is entering. Here, the amount of mass changes, obviously, the amount of energy changes. And you may have here, as you see, boundary work, right? You may have shafts crossing. You may have electrical wires crossing. So you can have all kinds of things. Okay, so in general, how do we approach this? It is really, although it looks complicated, still very simple, nothing new. Okay, mass balance and energy balance. In the case of mass, mass entering minus mass leaving is simply the change in mass of the control volume. That's it. So you choose your control volume as your system. See what is entering, how much mass is entering, and how much mass is leaving. The difference is the amount of change in the mass of the system. Easy enough? And what is the change in the mass of the system? Well, just your, like the, you know, money in your bank account, the final mass after the process ends minus initial mass before the process begins. That's it. If at the beginning it was 2 kilogram, and when the process ends, it was 5 kilograms, okay? Obviously the change in mass is 3 kilograms there. Okay, energy balance, same way. Can energy in minus energy out is energy change. Okay, and what is energy in? You can keep in mind the mechanisms. Okay, we may have heat as energy in, energy out. We may have work as energy entering, leaving, and we may have mass. Okay, mass entering, mass leaving. We don't have to have all of them at once, but in general, we may have all of them. So in general, what is energy in? Q in minus work in minus energy in. Keep in mind theta is enthalpy plus kinetic energy plus potential energy. In general, these are negligible, but let's keep it general as theta. And we may have more than one inlet. So let's use a summation sign. Is Q out plus W out plus energy by mass, which is M theta out. We may have more than one exit. So the difference is the change in energy, which is M2 E2 minus M1 E1. Okay. Now this is not fluid stream. Now this is the system. Okay. The amount of energy here. The amount of energy of entering is theta. Okay. With a flow of energy. So theta is, if you neglect the kinetic and potential energies, which is usually the case, okay, H, but E is within the control volume, it is not flowing, is U when kinetic potential energies are negligible. And usually they are. Okay. So in that case, the energy equation will look like this. Let's say Q minus W, you can say like Q in net minus W out net is the change in enthalpy plus the change in the energy of the system. Okay. Okay, do I have to memorize this? No, just go through this. Always start with this one and do the simplifications. Okay. So, as a special case, if you close the entrance and the exit of a control volume, keep in mind that it will reduce to a closed system because no mass is entering and no mass is leaving. So when you do an analysis, energy analysis, okay, keep in mind that if you make, let's say, mass entering, mass leaving zero, your result should correspond to what? Closed system energy analysis. And also, as I mentioned before, keep in mind a system may involve boundary work, electrical work, shaft work, okay, and as well as mass entering and leaving here. And that's it. Okay. The rest is simply examples. So this is, I think, the basic concepts, what is involved, but nothing new, as you see here. Okay. So let's go through the examples to make sure we understand. Okay. What is this example? We have a rigid insulated tank initially evacuated. Okay, let's stop there. We have this tank. It is insulated, as you see the insulation here. Okay. And initially evacuated. So what is M1? Zero. Okay, it is rigid. It cannot have any boundary work. It cannot move the boundaries. Okay, let's continue. It's connected through a valve to a supply line that carries steam at 1 megapascal and 300 degrees. Okay. Now the valve is opened and steam is allowed to flow slowly into the tank until the pressure reaches 1 megapascal. So the final pressure is 1 megapascal, at which point the valve is closed to determine the final temperature of the steam in the tank. So what is the final temperature? Okay, can anyone tell me the result right away? Initially, there was nothing inside, okay? And we have steam at 1 megapascal, 300 degrees. We open the valve and steam enters at 1 megapascal, 300 degrees. The pressures are equalized, 1 megapascal, and we close the valve. What is the temperature inside? Do you think it will be 300?
Yes. Yeah, me too.
Yeah, it looks that way, right? It looks that way. Probably I would say the same thing. Yeah, you know, this steam entering, you know, nothing to change, right? No work interactions, no heat interactions, and nothing leaving. So it will just be 300 since the pressure is the same there. It will look that way. But this is the beauty of and the importance of analysis. It turns out not to be that way. Okay? Okay, why? So let's do this carefully. Okay, we know what the problem is. Now, assumptions. This can be analyzed as a uniform flow. It is truly uniform flow because the inlet conditions are uniform here. Okay? At the inlet, steam is always at 1 megapascal, 300 degrees. Okay? And the kinetic and potential energies of the streams are negligible. Yeah, there are no mentions of velocities, elevations, whatever. So I think this is a very easy assumption to make. The tank is stationary. There is, it is not like on the truck, you know, accelerating, whatever. No mention of those. Therefore, for the tank, the system, the changes in kinetic potential energies are zero. Do you realize that we look at the streams and the control volume separately? That is, the system may be stationary, this tank here, but here, let's say the kinetic energies can be significant. So they are, you know, different things. So we look at both of them. And since this is the case, delta E system is delta U system, okay? There are no boundary electrical shaft work interactions. We don't see any work interactions. And the tank is well insulated so that there is no heat transfer, okay? So these are the observations. Now, we take the tank as a system, as you see with the dashed lines here, okay? Right there. So the tank is the system. Why is it important that we specify the system? Because for energy interactions, we look at the boundary. Let's say here, mass is crossing the boundary, so mass is entering, okay? But no heat, no work, okay? Although you may have other things here, we don't care. It is not part of the system there. Okay, we take the tank as the system. It's a control volume since mass crosses the system boundary during the process. We observe that this is an unsteady flow process since the changes occur within the control volume. The amount of mass, the amount of energy, conditions, they all change at a given point. The control volume is initially evacuated, therefore, initial mass is zero. Therefore, M1 U1 will be zero. Also, there is one inlet and no exit. One inlet, no exit. And the microscopic energies of flowing and non-flowing fluids are represented by enthalpy and internal energy. So for flowing fluid, the microscopic energy is H. For non-flowing fluid, the microscopic energy is U. The kinetic potentials are negligible anyway. Okay. Then the energy balance and mass balance. Okay. Mass in, mass out, mass change. Okay. We don't have any mass out, but we have mass in. And we don't have any initial mass. So what is the result? Mass in is equal to final mass. Logical? Initially no mass, so whatever mass enters is the final mass in the tank. Reasonable, right? Okay, energy. Again, see, we don't go back and use long equations. We always start with the basic equation. Okay, we do this throughout the entire book here, a systematic, you know, consistent approach. So energy in minus energy out is energy change. This is the same equation for closed system. You can use it for anything really. And energy in and out can be by heat. But in this case, we don't have any heat transfer. Can be by work. We don't have any work interaction by mass. And we have only mass entering. And the energy of mass flowing is H. The amount is Mi, okay? So this is energy entering by mass. And energy leaving by heat, work, mass? No, nothing. Okay. And delta E system, it is U2 minus U1 in this case, since kinetic potential energies are negligible, but initially evacuated, so it is U2, which is M2 U2. Okay. What else? Mi is equal to M2, right? The mass that enters, mass in, equals to final mass in the tank. Okay, then Mi and M2 here will cancel. So what do we have? U2 is equal to Hi. This is the end of the energy and mass analysis combined. So the conservation of mass and conservation of energy principles together, they reduce to this simple equation that the final internal energy in the tank will be equal to the enthalpy of the entering steam. And I know the pressure, P1 here, right? I also know, P2 here, final state. I also know U2, it gives me two properties. That means I can determine any property, including T2. How do I do that? I go to steam tables, okay? Probably this is a superheated still. I'll check. It will be like, P1 megapascal, okay, in table A6. And here you have T, and then here you have U, okay? So you find this 1 megapascal, and then you find this U value, U2, and you simply read the corresponding T2 here. That should be the final temperature, okay? So this is when we read Hi at the inlet conditions, this is Hi. And then P2 is 1 megapascal, U2 is Hi. So you do what I just did. You read 456.1 degrees. Uh-oh, it is not 300 degrees. Did we make a mistake? So the temperature goes from 300 to 456. So 156 degrees increase in temperature. Huge.
Can you explain this question again?
It is what I was going to ask you. What happened here? Now, remember the refrigerant? How the temperature dropped when it passed through the capillary tube? A temperature drop of 60 degrees. Do you remember that?
Yes.
It is exactly what happens in reverse. Here in the flowing fluid, right here, okay, right here, we have enthalpy, right? Which is internal energy plus flow energy. When it enters the tank, okay, what happens to flow energy? Is the fluid still flowing? No.
No.
No, and that flow energy is converted to internal energy. Okay, this is what happens there. If let's say you are still not sure, you can solve this problem assuming closed system. Okay, look at this figure. Now let's imagine imagine a section of the pipe like this, okay? The steam is 1 megapascal and the amount of and 300 degrees and the amount of steam is the amount that will enter the tank. You can imagine the upstream steam as a piston, imaginary piston, okay? Kind of pushing this in, okay? And as you see, there will be some, you know, boundary work done here. And then it is entering there. But this is the only moving boundary. So there is no other boundary work involved. Then this whole thing becomes the system. Internally, what goes on, we don't care, like here. It is part of in something internal. Doesn't involve any energy interactions there. But this is, it is being compressed, okay? It is boundary work. A pressure of 1 megapascal doing that work, okay? So that work energy is now in the system. And if you solve it this way as a closed system, again, you will get the same result as you see here, okay? Any questions? So this is how you find the boundary work. Again, this is the importance of science, okay? And the beauty of learning all the details and intricacies of things, okay? So this is not, you know, superficial learning. This is deep learning. You understand what's happening and you intuitively kind of visualize the transformations of energy. Energy being turned into a different form. Flow of energy into internal energy, as you see here, or in the case of refrigerant, internal energy, okay, being turned to flow of energy. And the temperature is dropping hugely. I mean, that simple thing is, I think, what makes the refrigerators and air conditioners work. So this is not, you know, theoretical. This is what we see in practice. Okay, let's go through another example. Now, discharge of heating air at constant temperature. Now, we have an insulated, okay, again, we read every word carefully. Insulated, what does it mean? What is zero? If this is insulated, heat transfer is zero, right? 8 cubic meter rigid tank. Rigid tank, what does it mean? Boundary work is zero because the volume doesn't change. It contains air. And when we see the word air, what we think? It's an ideal gas. Unless we have extreme conditions like minus 100 degrees and I don't know, 500 atmospheres or whatever. Normally ideal gas, okay. At 600 kilopascal, 400 kelvin, oh, they are fine, no problem there. And a valve connected to the tank is now opened and air is allowed to escape until the pressure inside drops to 200, okay. So the pressure drops from 600 to 200 kilopascal. The air temperature during this process is maintained constant by an electric resistance heater, as you see here, okay, placed in the tank. Determine the electrical energy supplied to air during this process. So what is this electrical work? That is the question, okay? Now, it's an unsteady flow process because the amount of mass and energy changes inside. The conditions change. And it is uniform flow because the air conditions here, the temperature is 400 Kelvin, okay? The pressure changes. The pressure is not constant, it changes. But probably we will need only the enthalpy here, And enthalpy depends on temperature only for ideal gases. So pressure change doesn't really affect us. So we don't need to take any average or something. Okay. Again, kinetic and potential energies are negligible. The tank is insulated, therefore heat transfer is zero. Air is an ideal gas. This time we assume variable specific heats, meaning we will not use Cp delta T. We will just use enthalpies from the tables. Okay, we take the contents of the tank as the system, which is a control volume, the volume here, the dashed lines. now, the microscopic energies, okay, for this flowing fluid outside, it is H. For the stationary inside, it is U. Okay, we keep that in mind. Now, mass balance. Again, no change. Mass in minus mass out is mass change within the system. Do we have any mass entering? No. So mass leaving is simply, or minus mass leaving is the change of the mass of the system, okay, which is M2 minus M1. Rearrange, this is what you get. And this is what the logic is, right? The amount of mass that leaves is the difference between the initial mass and the final mass. So this is what we have there. Now for our energy, again, energy in minus energy of this energy change, okay? Energy in, energy out through the mechanisms of heat, but we don't have any heat. It is insulated. Work, we have electric work and mass, and we have only exiting mass. We don't have any inlet. Therefore, in electric, not exit, okay. W electric in, entering, and no heat, no mass, that's it. So what is leaving? No heat, no mass leaving, but mass is leaving. So, and energy is enthalpy for leaving fluid dash, M exit, H exit. Now the change in energy of the system, M2U2, final energy, since kinetic potential energies are negligible, minus M1U1. Okay, so this is the energy equation. If you rearrange it, this equation here, you will get this. Okay. Therefore, if you know the masses and the properties of air, obviously, the problem is easy to solve. Okay, masses. Ideal gas. I know the volume is constant, okay? And initial pressure is this. Temperature is also constant at 400, okay? So using ideal gas relation, PV, masses, PV over RT. Again, PV over RT. I can determine initial mass, final mass, and the difference is the amount of mass that exits. So masses are known. Okay, if you go to the air table, which is table 17, okay, you will see T and then U and H. Okay, the temperature is 400 Kelvin, okay? So you read U and then H there, corresponding to 400. Which are these values, okay? Since the temperature is the same, U1, U2 are the same. What is next? Just plug in all the values and you get the amount of electrical work done, which is 3200 kilojoule in kilowatt hour, 0.889 kilowatt hours, okay? If, as a special case, the temperature changed, okay, we would simply take the average exit temperature and we would calculate HE at the average temperature, which would be approximate there, but sufficiently accurate. Okay, any questions on this problem and the solution? So no question, and this is the end of the chapter. Okay. Mehmetcan probably will send you what the problems are. I assigned 5 problems from this chapter. You have 2 weeks to do those. And I think that this Friday, he will solve some more problems, okay? And next week, we don't do anything. But the following week, we will start with the second law of thermodynamics. So what we have done so far is simply conservation of energy. Hopefully, you understand what, you know, conservation of energy is and how to solve engineering problems using this principle. Next time, we will start the second law, which is a expansion of energy. So I'll see you in 2 weeks. Okay.